Therefore, we need more time to discuss. But since Chandrashekhar ji has something to say, I'm just allowing him to. That's why we had let us gain some time. I know it.
Mr. Speaker, sir,
please.
With anguish and deep concern,
yes.
I am going to read a letter that was published on 30th May 1974, just after the explosion of nuclear device in India. The letter was published in New York Times, and the letter was written by one of the officials of the Government of India, today's official of the Government of India. It is a matter of grave concern because it does not only puts a question mark about the national policies, but also asks the superpowers to intervene in the affairs of this country. I do not know what prompted the present government to appoint this official in a very key position. But, Mr. Speaker, I shall be failing in my national duty if I don't bring to your notice, to the notice of this House, and to the people of this country about the gravity of the appointment of this official. I may be permitted, I know I have very short time. I shall just read the papers. I shall not make any speech on that. The letter is, after India's peaceful nuclear blast, the international community must wake up more vigorously to prevent India from embarking upon a nuclear weapons program, as well as to block further proliferation. It will probably not be before the mid-80s that India will have implemented the Sarabhai program for a balanced nuclear infrastructure and be faced with the next crucial decision on whether or not it should go in for a weapon program. Mrs. Gandhi has muted the light demand for a quick bomb. She is not unaware of the crippling cost of nuclear weapons and their worthlessness in war. Nor is there much enthusiasm among the military for nuclear weaponry. On the other hand, the world community cannot accept New Delhi's declaration that it will not make nuclear weapons as an adequate and credible guarantee that India, having acquired the capability, will forever remain a nuclear pacifist. After all, the Rajasthan blast was not triggered off by any perceived threat to India's security. It was ordered by Mrs. Gandhi at a singularly inappropriate time in the mistaken belief that the heralding of India's nuclear capability would lift the country from its current despondency and gloom. If the blast was a political mistake, it will be a worse folly on the part of the international community to try to punish India by cutting off or withholding development aid. In any case, such a strategy will not work because whatever the Soviet Union may think about the Indian explosion, they are not going to deny India development assistance. What the international community must ask of India now is a formal commitment to the UN Security Council that it will never undertake the manufacture of nuclear weapons, and that such a commitment be written into the Indian Constitution through an amendment sponsored by the Government of India. These two measures alone can reassure the world that India will not use its nuclear capability for destructive purposes. If Mrs. Gandhi refuses to take them, a mere undertaking to the Security Council will not be enough simply because it is not enforceable. She will have betrayed or confirmed what many suspect to be India's true nuclear ambitions. To prevent further proliferation, the Moscow Test Ban Treaty must now be extended to cover underground test. The two supporters must determinedly move towards substantial and not merely symbolic nuclear arms control and disarmament, and the non-proliferation treaty should be revised to remove some of the clauses that the nuclear have-nots considered to be discriminatory against their vital interests. Bhavani Sen Gupta, the writer, is senior fellow at Research Institute on Communist Affairs, Columbia University. This Bhavani Sen Gupta has been appointed an officer in the PMO, officer on special duty. I am told that he has got a secretary rank. Since the day he has been appointed, he has been making statements, which is the concern of all thinking people in this country. Editorials have been written. There has been news that Ministry of External Affairs officers don't know whether they can give sensitive documents to this person. I do not know whether the Prime Minister knew about the credentials of this gentleman. I have nothing against him. I have no rancor. But Mr. Speaker, sir, if this was the opinion of this officer, I cannot even think of this officer being in the Prime Minister's office even for a moment. I wrote to you, Mr. Speaker, yesterday afternoon I came to know about it, and I simultaneously wrote a letter to the Prime Minister that he should immediately ask to relinquish his office. There, I am told that there is another letter written by the same gentleman, which has been also published, and in that it has been said it is not enough. India should be summoned before the Security Council. And if they don't agree to this proposal to amend the Constitution as desired, then whole superpower community should impose sanction on India. This is the view. And not only that, after becoming the officer of a super nature, he has made the policy statement on Siachen, he has made the policy statement of nuclear program. I don't know whether, I have never seen such an officer in the whole annal of world history. Hard to talk of India. I have nothing to say. I don't want to pass any comment about it. But I don't know what the government will do. They will be pleased to retain this officer. But I caution the country about the nefarious designs of such appointments. I don't know on whose behalf it has been done. I caution the people, I caution the officers of the government of India that any paper of sensitive nature should not be given to this officer.
Well, please listen to me. I don't think it is a matter which should be, please sit down. This should be debated.